Good morning to all of you.
Good morning.
Glad to see such a big crowd today. Did any of you have to bring a boat to get to church today? Thought I had seen everything till this week again, but we certainly had our share of water. Anybody have their house flood? Ours was within about 30 minutes. Our famous ditch behind us where we live backed up, and we had water up to the foundation, and thankfully, the city came and fixed something that had re-presented itself as a problem. But it wasn't pleasant. Never seen so much water. Anyway, glad you could be here today. Glad you can enjoy services, and hopefully you won't have any more problems. Maybe things will settle down a little bit. What do most of us want for the churches of God? Now, that's kind of a loaded question. A lot of things we want. I think a lot of times we would love to have more young people because we are literally an old church, and there are not a lot of young people around like there used to be. I think a lot of times we would like to see more young ministers. I thought of myself being a young minister for quite a while, but it's no longer true. It's happened where you get to a certain point, and that doesn't apply anymore. There's all sorts of things that we would like to have, but I think one thing that we all can agree on and look for and would like to see happen that we don't have much and haven't had for a number of years is growth. And there are probably some reasons for that. The growth and the increased attendance in many cases is just a scattering of people from one group to the next, you know, trying to look for a new home. And while that does provide a purpose and is good and is great, we'd like to see more people from the outside come in and join us and, you know, have some new blood, so to speak, and see people who need help and who need to change their lives changing their lives, because a lot of people don't understand what is wrong with their life and why things are the way that they are. Well, when you ask yourself why we don't have more growth, that's a good question. It's a good thing to come up with an answer. You know, the question I have is God waiting on us to do something? Is he expecting something from us as people, as members? Possibly. Possibly he is. But there are other things to consider as well. You know, we need to think about it. Mr. Watkins gave a sermon a few weeks ago, and he mentioned what was mentioned in the book of Haggai about God telling the people of Israel to consider their ways. And maybe we need to consider our ways sometimes as to what we're doing. You know, in business, if you're in business or familiar with business and you work for businesses, which all of us are connected in some way or another, they are all the time having charts, graphs, trends within the business world, within their particular field, whether it be automotive or a restaurant or whether it be in retail. They're looking for changes. They're looking for ideas. They're looking to try to improve things. They send out surveys all the time. These surveys drive me crazy, but I went to get my oil changed in my Toyota Tundra this week and went through three surveys with them after it happened. I mean, You go in, you get your oil changed, and you leave, and the next day you get a phone call, and they want you to do a survey. They ask you before you leave, when you pay your bill, three or four questions if things went well, which is great. The next day you get a phone call asking the same questions again. Well, then the next day you get an email. They've already signed you up for a return visit for our next oil change in 6 months, which I'm usually there before that anyway. But they go to great lengths to make sure that, you know, that you're happy with what's going on. I bought something the other day in one of the stores, and at the bottom of it was about three or four questions of a survey they wanted you to answer. You know, did you feel at home when you came in the shop? Were you helped? Did people know what they were talking about? Did you have to ask for help? Did you have to wait too long for service? I mean, it just was on and on and on. And businesses want to make sure that they're taking care of you. And so we can apply a little bit of that to us as a church, because we want to make sure that we're doing what we need to do to encourage other people, you know, to come. For one thing, ask them. to come to church if they got a problem. You know, nothing that they have to commit to. But people are, when you start talking about churches, people are so sensitive about getting involved and having to, you know, to come in and answer too many questions, and they're a little hesitant to do that. We have a lot of people that listen out on the webcast that we may never come in contact with and who never may come to church. But we would love to invite them to go somewhere that's close to them. You know, if you look in the bulletin came out, the church bulletin from February the 20th, a couple weeks ago, and I was totally impressed with what had happened down here with the total responses to one of the programs that Bill Watson did on the Kingdom of God. There were 477 new contacts that particular week with a 45% new responses. That's a tremendous percentage of responses for new contacts. And I don't think it was just people surfing from one group to the next. I think some of those people are probably new. You know, and the webcast views that week were almost 16,000. That's a lot of people. A lot of people. I don't know if you were to put all of the membership of the Churches of God together, I don't even know what it would be these days, but when I was growing up, I believe it was about 150,000. Was that correct? Do you remember? It was somewhere close to that.
It was 250 at one time.
250? Okay, it was a lot higher than what I thought, but maybe that was the income. It was $150 million a year at that point. But when you put all the festival sites together today with people attending the feast, how many of them are there attending the feast? Maybe 10%, 25,000 worldwide? Not very many. Not very many. But anyway, the opportunity for things to be able to happen and things taking place is really wonderful. I think we're seeing some really great opportunities. How many of you were, I know one of the things we did years ago, and this goes back a long way, but in 1970, they had what was called the America Listen campaign. I know a few of you that were used to be around a long time like me were there. How many of you here went to one of those? Okay, about a half a dozen of you. I asked this up in Cleveland, and there was only one person that had been to one of them. That was Bill Watson. I didn't realize he went back that far, but he does. And lo and behold, I found out we played in a softball tournament together in 1978 and didn't even know he was there. But we did. We played in Toledo. But those campaigns were done where they went out. They had a speaker that put on a big program, and it was really a wonderful opportunity. And back in that time in the church's history, there was always a figure of growing approximately 30% a year, which was phenomenal. 30% is pretty good number, because if you just think of the church here, say if it was 50 people, you know, 30%. In 1 year would add quite a few people to this congregation. And if you project that over 2 or 3 or 4 years, you know, before too long, you've doubled the size of the congregation. Well, when you do something like that, you've got to have people in place to take care of these people, answer their questions, help them with problems, and go through all the things that need to be done. And no bigger than this room is, you wind up with having to go to two services. You know, we don't do too much of that anymore. We just don't have a need for it. But back then, you know, there was always a church that was splitting and let me change the term there, not splitting, expanding. They would expand from morning to afternoon, or they would have a satellite group, you know, 50 to 75 miles away to kind of help ease the crowd that was there. We all want to see growth, and we look to growth. And Jesus said in Matthew 28 and verse 19, a scripture that you're familiar with in the book of Matthew at the end of the chapter there. He said, "To go therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you." Now, when you begin to go and teach and baptize and talk about what needs to be observed, that's a point is many times forgotten. There's things that are going to need to be told to people, and when you talk about what needs to be observed and done, there's going to be disagreement. And so one of the things that you have to do as a member is you have to know and understand the Scripture. And you have to know and understand where people are going to go, because there are going to be those that are going to disagree with you. When you think about going out and teaching, baptizing, explaining to people, not everybody's going to respond the right way. You remember Jesus said in the New Testament to go out, and if somebody doesn't, you know, agree with what you're saying, to wipe the dust off your shoes and go on to the next town. That's just something we have to be aware of. But we have to also be aware of a certain way of doing things and making sure that we are set, that we're in place, that we know what we're talking about, and making sure probably the most important example of Christian living is the way that you live your life, that your example is a good example. Because if people can see that you have changed your life and that you're living your life a different way and that things are working out for you because you are making corrections along the way, maybe that will be some kind of an insight to them to want to ask you some questions as to why, when things are falling down around us as a world and as a society, that we can remain somewhat calm and collected and knowledgeable of where things are going. You know, I run into people all the time that just can't believe things are the way they are, yet we can't believe they are the way they are either, except for the fact that we know where it's going to end. And most of the people out there don't know where it's going to end. They really don't. They don't know what's going to happen after they die. And then some of them are terrified about it. But you and I do have that understanding and a way to be able to do that. Now, you know, God is not willing, as it says, that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And over the years, I've come to kind of understand that. Because we all want family and friends, co-workers or whatever, to join us, to be here, people that we know or people that we're involved with. But I've come to understand and see that maybe the reason God doesn't call everyone at once is because they don't have the character to overcome in this life the way that we would like to see it. Maybe he knows something a little more than what we do. You know, God doesn't want anybody to perish, and the program is in place, if you will, with the death of Christ for all mankind to be saved. But God is only choosing a few people to do a job and do a work now whereby to prepare for what might occur later on during his kingdom. Because you and I are not the only ones that have the opportunity to be in God's kingdom. All of mankind does. And there's some pretty wicked people out there. And when I think about some of the people that I know, and I don't mean they're all wicked, I just mean the average person that has no interest in God and no interest in changing their life, I don't think they could make it in this time because of their lack of character, because of their lack of interest, as we'll see in something I'll show you here in a little bit. Over in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul made a statement, and it kind of gives us an idea of what we have to prepare for if we hope to be an example, hope to help people come to see and understand what we see. Now, granted, God has to, and I think you're aware of the scripture in the book of John where God says that no man can come to him except the Father draw him. So God has to call a person, but you and I may be that catalyst whereby God will use us or use you or your example or your answer to one of their questions as to why they may become and want to become involved. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6. Paul said, I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So there is the formula by which these things need to take place. You know, the one thing about the New Testament church, what kind of society did they live under? Well, it was a pretty rough time with the Roman Empire being what it was. They had a lot of persecution. They had people who were against what was taking place. They had the Jewish group who was totally against what Christ had brought and what Christ was doing. And in spite of all the things that occurred in the New Testament church with the issues of the Gentiles coming in, which was a huge uproar within the church for a little while till it got straightened out. But once the Gentile world came in and people began to be converted, What took place within the New Testament church? Growth. First couple books of, or first chapters of Acts after the day of Pentecost, I think in one occasion it said 3,000 were baptized, and in one case, 5,000. I'll tell you right now, we couldn't handle that here today in Tyler. We couldn't. What happened if we had 100 want to be baptized? We would have our hands full. We really would. And I've always felt that one of the things of planting the Word of God and planting an interest in God in people's minds, as too often happens, and I know is going to happen in the future, are tragedies. You know, after 9/11, how many more of a percentage of people attended church for the first 6 months or 9 months than were attending before it happened? It was a tremendous increase and growth. Now, granted, it didn't last, but you know how people are when tragedies strike. People get involved. With the things that we're doing with the internet and the webcast and reaching a number of people who are out there on the webcast today watching, however many are out there, we consider them a part of the Tyler Church of God. We may never see them. We may never meet them. But believe me, many of those feel that they're a part of this group, just like those of us that are here. And I think it's a tremendous opportunity to just welcome them and ask them, if they're close to a group, make contact and get together with them. We are not really in too many different cases than what the Apostle Paul went through. And I love this section of Scripture in Acts 17, because I think we're very similar to what took place during the time of Paul and what we're going through now, where Paul was in the city of Athens and wandering around the city, kind of taking view of things and realizing that there were a lot of idols there and how the city was set up and what it was like with the philosophies that were being bantered around and talked about and everybody looking for answers for things. And Paul walks around Mars Hill in verse 22 and mentions to the men of Athens that I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious, because they're searching for answers about life and the gods and everything. And he said, for I passed by and beheld your devotions, and I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. Did you ever think that you and I are in that position? There are a lot of people out there that don't believe in God, don't care about God. They're too wrapped up with what they're doing. There are people out there who kind of wonder if there really is a God, mainly because they've never had any experience with him, and with the problems in the world, they have this thought, well, if there was a God, why doesn't God do something? If God really loved mankind, why doesn't he do something? Well, we know God did something. He gave us the life of his son as a sacrifice. There are those out there who believe in God and want nothing else to do with God. They don't want to change their lives. They don't want to become involved. They're too busy. But they do believe that there is a God. And when I see this, to the unknown God, I think you and I have an opportunity to talk to people about the unknown God that they don't know, that they don't understand really does exist and really does have something he expects us to do. You know, the three things about God is that we need to know who he is, we need to know what he expects of us, of mankind, and what he has in store for mankind. And you and I have those answers. And a lot of people out there don't, even those that attend church somewhere. They just don't know what it's all about. I had some friends of mine a few years ago, and I know they meant this kind of halfway kiddingly, but they said the reason they went to the biggest church in Tyler was because it was a great place to make business contacts. And that was a statement from them. And they were partially right. I knew what they were getting at. But that's what was their whole attitude. You know, Paul went into this place here in Athens. He established some common ground with this group of people here. And as he began to talk to them and call to them about God, he began to tell them that what God expects of people is, to be specific, repentance. Or to not be so specific, to be more subtle, to change their life. because this is what God wants. This is what God expects. You know, the story of that Jeff was telling in the announcement about the Philippines really fascinates me. The number of people over there, the energy of those people when I saw services, it was tremendous to see people from another country, you know, halfway around the world, so involved, and to hear about their work of things that are going on. I know when I was in Israel 4 years ago, we saw busload after busload after busload of people visiting the sites in Israel from South Korea, of all places. I would never have expected that, but it was just busload after busload after busload. And our tour guide was telling us that 4 years ago, the last couple years, they had just, you know, thousands of people coming over there from South Korea, which is a long trip to go to Israel of all places. And I was really surprised by that. But these were people who had turned to Christianity and were serious about it. It wasn't just something they picked up and decided that they would think about, you know, for a time being. They were involved with it. And they were involved and excited about seeing a number of the things that I was wanting to see. So there's a world out there, and I think here recently, this last year, has been a tremendous encouragement or inspiration, if you will, to see a number of the Arab people who have embraced Christianity and who have been willing to give up their heads because of it and give up everything in their lives because of it. It's been something that I was surprised by in some way because I wasn't that familiar with it, but, you know, when you give up your head and give up your life, literally, for something you believe in, you know, I think God takes notice of that. And it's an example for us of what we believe and what we understand. But Paul did a tremendous job over there in dealing with the unknown God. And I think sometimes that in where we live with Christianity as big as it is here in the United States, there are a lot of people who need to know about the unknown God that you and I have an opportunity to help understand about him. Now, they may not agree with us on everything, but we could sit down and at least have a nice talk. Because Jesus was very specific in Matthew 28 in that last verse 20. He said, go out and baptize, but teaching them to observe what he commanded the disciples to observe. That's pretty simple, pretty basic. You know, my mother went round and round with my grandmother for years. I've mentioned this before, so if I repeat myself, I'm sorry, but I just wanted to kind of mention this again. My mother was so excited about what she came across in 1958 with the radio program, and she took the Bible correspondence course, and I remember them listening to this radio program and this preacher who was thumping and kind of yelling at times about things and about life. But my mom was so excited about it, she just had to tell her mother about it. And my grandmother was not happy. She always referred to the church as that church. And she was never happy about it. My mom, every time we'd get together, would try to share with her some of the things that she had learned. And my grandmother just, you know, was not interested. She said, you were raised a Nazarene, and, you know, you don't need to be changing into anything. And they fought like cats and dogs for years until the day my grandmother died when she was 93, back in the late 90s, and she always told me, she said, I hope someday you'll see that church is just not the place you need to be. But they went round and round over Christmas and gifts and, you know, dragging them in one day and dragging them out a few hours later and back and forth. And in spite of all that, my mom really was trying to be a light. She was trying to, you know, tell my grandmother what it was like, and she didn't want any part of it. And it went on for years and years and years, and that's just the way it goes. You know, I come in contact with a lot of people here in Tyler that I've known for years and years that may not go or attend anywhere else anymore. But I know them, and I always make a point of trying to stop and say hello to them. About 3 weeks ago, I was in one of the hospitals, and I was meeting with the people I need to meet with. Is up at the UT Health Center. And I was getting ready to leave, and I started down the hallway, and somebody was yelling John Reedy at me, from up the hallway. So I had no idea what was going on. I really didn't. Well, it was a lady that I had gone to college with. She was a couple years older, and I invited her back to church. She attends one of the other groups, and she's been here a couple times over the last few years. And so we talked for probably 15 or 20 minutes, and I said, you know, just go ahead and come to church. A lot of people would like to see you. And several of you know her. And she said, well, I might do that. I haven't been there in a while, and I'd like to see some of the people. So she may show up one of these days. I don't know. But I always make it a point of trying to, you know, let people know that they're more than welcome. And I think that's something that we can do as people. I know about 5 or 6 years ago, we were over in Florida attending the feast with a couple different groups that had gotten together. And there was another group there that was a very, very closed group. They were keeping the feast, and they were down the hallway from where we were. They were in a fairly small room, and this particular group I was with was in a pretty big room. And so I found out what group it was, and I found out that this lady who was a minister's wife, her husband had died several years ago, and I worked with him up in Canada. And so I proceeded to come up with a plan to try to make contact. Well, they were so closed, everybody kept telling me, don't try to go in there, they won't let you in. Well, that just infuriates me. So I came up with a plan to kind of work my way down to the room and everything, and they, of course, screened me, and I told them who I was, and I would like to see this lady because I worked with her husband and her in Canada for several years. And so they said, well, they'd have to get permission, so I had to stand over here out of the way. And so they had about 150. And so lo and behold, she couldn't wait to say hello. And so they invited me in. I went in and spent about 20 or 30 minutes talking to a number of the people. And she introduced me to her two daughters, who were about 1 and 2 when I was in Canada. Had a great visit, with somebody who was part of a group that did not want contact with anyone. Well, I made the contact. I at least opened the door. And then I found out that one of the ladies that was attending there, her daughter was in college with me, and I dated her a couple times. And so we talked for quite a while. So you never know who you're going to run into. You never know where this will come to be and how it may turn out. But you've got to at least be willing to make contact with people and share some things with them and at least be friendly. Sometimes that's all it takes, is just being friendly. We've had enough of not being friendly with each other over the years. So just, you know, be friendly and let people know that, hey, it doesn't matter that you're a little different than me or you go to someplace else than I do, we can be friends. Because you're friends with neighbors who may not believe anything like you, who may not even believe in God. Isn't that not correct? Or people at work that are working with you in a business or a place of employment, who may be some pretty rough people, but you can at least be friendly to them. Kindness will, you know, do a lot with people. Over in Matthew chapter 13, let's move on here before I run out of time. I would love to see more growth, and I think all of us really would. And we've got to plant things to begin with. So however you can plant the Word of God with somebody is between you and them. And there are so many ways to do it. We don't have time to go through the parable of the sower. But when you talk about plants and you talk about how they grow, how they develop, and the parable that was given here, you know, there's so much to learn from all of this and to think about. You know, plants need four things. Some of you are going to be planting a garden. I'm being told that it's much easier just to go and buy it because it's a lot less work. And that's true. A lot less leaning over, too. But plants need four things. They need a growing medium. They need water and sunlight and temperature. Now, it needs to be in a balance. What we're having right now with almost 9 inches of rain this week is a little bit too much. But you've got to have these qualities together for plants to be productive and to do what they need to and to be able to grow. And so when you start talking about the environment, yeah, you can't just throw the Word of God out there to somebody and expect change. It may take some time. It may take take something that you've said over the years or weeks prior for somebody to think back about it. So you've got to know your Bible. You've got to know the scriptures. You've got to know where you're going. And it probably wouldn't be a bad idea for all of you to sit down and have a little plan, a little program of 4 or 5 points is, how do I take this person who knows nothing about God to come to understand a little bit about God? You got to have a plan in place to do that. This parable of the sower is very interesting, where it talks about the four different types of soil where the word was planted. You know, the focus of the sower here was on the quality of the soils. And you know how horrible it is to try to plant seed in soil that just is not going to work. You know, that which was by the wayside, the footpaths, the hard soil where there was never a root system to be able to develop and support the plants. You know, we come across people like that all the time. People that are so involved with whatever in life, nothing else has a chance to really root with them. Whether it be, you know, their job or their lifestyle or their interest or whatever. You know, things are just not going to sit well with them because of what they're involved with. The stony places, the rocky areas where you have no root at all. You know, you can't talk to somebody that does not believe in God if they don't want to hear about God. If they're more concerned about climate change or something else, you might as well forget it. It's just not going to work. And they'll tell you up front it's not. The weeded areas where the soil is just so full of weeds and other competition, there is just no way for things to take root. And believe me, the society we live in today is one that's full of weeds. So many things people can become involved with, can have an interest in, can influence them so much that they don't have time for a lot of things. You know, I think it's great with the interest in the electronic world to put God's word in the electronic world where people are so absorbed by it, people are so obsessed with it, that maybe they will come across the word of God through the internet or the phones. Phone systems in the job site are just a horrible situation. I mean, it's a problem. But if they would, you know, come across something about God and what God has to offer, maybe it would work. Maybe it would, you know, build something with them. And then you have the good soil. I look at the good soil as being those of us who have embraced God, embraced his way of life, and are doing our level best to try to change our lives with God's help to become more like Christ. In other words, building character. And there are a lot of people out there that are not interested in building character. They're more concerned about their own interests. And I think that's why a lot of people are not called today, because God wants them in his kingdom, but they don't have the character and the ability to do it in this day and age. And I think when we understand that, we can sympathize a little bit with why God is doing things the way he's doing. He's got a better plan and understanding than what we do. You have to, when you plant something with people, you have to plant with them what God expects. And what is it that God expects? Luke chapter 14. He expects us to count the cost. And there are a lot of people that don't want to count the cost. They just want to live their lives and kind of drift or float from one day to the next. You know, most of us, I think, look at life and take it as a way of what we need to be doing and how we need to be handling things. And we have a plan and a program in mind. The holy days keep us focused on God, and we take things, you know, year by year with what we're going to try to do and laying out plans to correct ourselves and our lives with God's help. So many people just drift from one day to the next and are unconcerned about what tomorrow brings. We are, because we know we've got one chance. It says here in Luke, if any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. The Greek word for disciple means a learner, an adherent, or an imitator of the teacher. So when people talk to you about being a disciple of Christ, are you imitating, are they imitating the life of Christ? Well, we certainly are. And Jesus said that whosoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. This whole scenario here of bearing the cross and of changing your life and becoming like the teacher is important. It's what is expected of us as Christians. And people don't like to hear that because it involves something they have to become involved with. It involves work. The book of Romans chapter 12 says that we are to present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy, which means set apart, and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. This is what God expects of us and wants us to do. And so we have to go about it the right way. We have to think about changing our lives. I think one of the most important things that you can tell people who come to you with a lot of problems, and I've done this over the years with people, but there's nothing more refreshing to people than to hear, as Jesus told the woman who was taken in adultery, when he said, "Go and sin no more." You know, that gives people a chance. That gives people hope. And I think so many people need that with what they've gone through in life. You know, the consequences of sin don't leave us when we embrace Christ, do they? You know, if we've been a drug addict, or if we've had problems in life with all sorts of scenarios that we could think about, those problems don't leave us when we embrace Christ, do they? We still have the mental scars. In some cases, we still have the physical scars. You know, our lives are forever going to bear the things that we've done in life. But we can be forgiven of our sins, and we can be freed of all these problems to continue on and to have a chance for salvation. This is what God makes available to us. And I think the simple fact that you know this and understand this, and somebody comes to you where they've reached the end of their rope and said, "I can't continue." I've dealt with three or four people over the years who were going to commit suicide. And thankfully, I was able to talk them out of it, because I said, there's so much more to think about than ending your life. And some of them have gone on to make course corrections along the way. But I've dealt with people who are alcoholics. I've dealt with people who have records like you wouldn't believe. And some of these people have changed their lives. And that's an opportunity and a chance to help people, because you can plant the Word of God with them just with your contact, just with your friendship, just with your understanding. And in some cases, all it takes, and this is hard for a lot of us to do, just to listen. Just to listen to somebody's problems and try to give them a couple words of advice. Secondly, Paul said that not only had he planted, Apollos had watered. That watering people is so important and so necessary. And it's something that we do every week. One of the places we do that is right here. Over in Jeremiah chapter 8, I heard this years ago from Ron Dart, who was a great mentor to me. And he used this word in the Hebrew, moed, which means appointed times. In Jeremiah, where he turned to it, it says, "Yes, the stork in heaven knows her appointed times, and the turtle and the crane and the swallow observe the time of their coming. But my people know not the judgment of the Lord. How do you say, 'We are wise, and the law of the Lord is with us'? Lo, certainly in vain made he it, and the pen of scribes is in vain. The wise men are ashamed, they are dismayed and taken. Lo, they have rejected the word of the Lord, and what wisdom is in them." You know, that word moed, if you do any research on it, talks about it, a time to focus and to develop a relationship with God. And you and I understand about that through the Sabbath day and through the holy days that are coming up. You know, this last night I was getting ready to go to the health club and went out to get in the truck, and there were 50 or 60 birds just all over the place right there where I was parked, around a couple of the trees there in front of the house. And the little neighbor girl came out and said, "Look at all these birds." Well, I just I looked at the birds because I want to know what kind they were. Female cardinals. Every year they come back at this time. They're yellow, kind of a yellow belly with gray leaves. Gray feathers. And they were up in the leaves on these trees and in the shrubs behind the house eating the red holly berries. They do this every year. And this beginning of last week, there were a lot of robins out. Well, you see, the thing is, these birds know the migratory pattern that they're on. They know what nature tells them. They're headed back to the north. They're only going to be here for a few days, and they're going to keep moving northward. You know, and as Jeremiah was pointing out here, these animals know their appointed time. They know what to do in life. We as people don't. We don't have an appointed time with God. Most people don't. You and I do. We come here every Sabbath. We keep the holy days. That's a time to focus and have a relationship with God that is so valuable in our watering, which you and I need as well. Not just mankind, but we need to be watered each week. We need to have that break, that rest, because we need to understand about changing our lives and the repentance that we need to have, not just at Passover time, but day in and day out. You know, man drifts so much further away from God without God than the animals do. And the animals aren't going to have a place and chance for salvation. Yet, they know and understand about God. One of the ways we can have and be close and be watered is to stay focused and close to Christ, John chapter 15. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that bears not fruit is taken away and purged. He says in verse 4, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abides in the vine. No more can you except you abide in me. We need that contact. We need that refreshing atmosphere. We need that being together with like-minded people where there is a unity, where there is a love, where there is the concern for one another. This is what helps us to grow and develop, to mature and to develop more character. You know, too little contact, no friendship, no fellowship is going to leave somebody vulnerable. And you and I know and understand that there is a roaring lion out there who's seeking to devour each and every one of us. To be more specific, to devour all of mankind. So we need to be close in our relationship. And this developing with people as they come along and this helping them to grow, giving them water. Too much water isn't good, believe me. Plants are struggling with the amount of moisture that we've had. I know the pansies we put in about 20,000 4-inch pansies in November, and they all but died because of the rains in December. They just were flooded. They couldn't develop a root system. They didn't need to develop a root system. They had too much water, and they almost smothered, literally. And they're just now starting to look a little bit better, except for the 9-inch rain we had here this last week. But you can't be too strong with people who are coming in and trying to learn. I remember when I was growing up, and I don't remember who the people were. I don't remember who was involved with this. But I was about 14 or 15 years old, and it was up in Indianapolis. And the worst sin you could have back in the late 60s, it was the worst problem you could have as a Christian. It was like the plague. You know what it was? Smoking. If you smoked, there is no way that you had a chance for anything in life. Not really, but it came on pretty strong. So I remember there was a man who came, he was new, and he had a problem with smoking. And I don't even know who the people were, I don't remember, because I was 14 or 15 and I wasn't concerned with adults back then. I had other things on my mind. Anyway, I remember this one gentleman befriended this person. He came up to him, and he was trying to help him. And I remember hearing him say, well, you've only been here a couple weeks. Well, let's get this problem fixed. Let's get it eliminated. Okay, okay. So a couple of weeks later, the gentleman came back, and I overheard him again, and he said, how are you doing? Are you correcting your problem? I said, no, I'm really struggling with it. I just can't seem to make a course correction. And this gentleman lit into him, and he said, what is wrong with you? I gave this up in 2 weeks' time. You know, it doesn't take somebody to be as weak as you are, and just literally gave him a hard time. Well, the gentleman never came back to church, because I heard later on he quit. It's one thing to help people. It's one thing to encourage people, but don't be after people to make them feel about this tall or wish that they could hide somewhere. You've got to have a friendship with people and give people time to change. Now, granted, it could be anything. It doesn't have to be, you know, smoking. It could be all sorts of problems. As you well know, you and I have gone through a lot of problems. And I think if you put this room together with all the problems that we have experienced as people and as Christians, we know what people are going through and we could help them with it. I don't think there are going to be too many new problems that would surface with new people coming in. We have dealt with that. But Christ died so that all could be saved. And Christ was patient when he caught the lady in adultery and said, go and sin no more. That's a certain amount of understanding and patience and giving somebody the opportunity to change their lives. So yeah, we need to do that. We need to try to help people grow and develop, but give them an opportunity to be human too along the way, that they may not be able to handle things as easily as you do. You know, there was a statement I heard years ago, and I think we sometimes forget it. And I think sometimes the reason people are hesitant to come to church is because they think the church and the people there are perfect. Forget that. You on the website, that's just not the way it is. Pastors and church members are not perfect. We make mistakes. We sin. And we have to repent and ask for forgiveness just like you do. So if you come into your congregation, realize that you are dealing with people that are just like you. They were not perfect, and we've got a long way to go. And if it wasn't for the fact of Christ's grace and mercy and forgiveness, we wouldn't be in any better place than what you are. But there is hope, and there's an opportunity to change your life. You know, so many people get caught up into things, and I think we need to also realize that when you're growing and you're developing, there are so many tragic stories about people that become involved with topics, with words, with statements, with other areas that they think are more spiritual that they get involved with, and then before you know it, it drags them away. Remember what it says in 1 Thessalonians, to prove all things and hold fast that which is good. Once you've proven something, and once you believe in something, and once you know it inside and out, don't reach for some new truth. Because too many people that reach for new truth wind up reaching for some new work that they feel is going to make them superior to what they have left. And my Bible says it's not the works, it's not the things we do that's going to gain us salvation. What is going to gain us salvation is what? For by grace are you saved through faith. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So my salvation does not depend on how I'm going to look or how I'm going to feel or how many times I'm able to give sermons or come to Sabbath service or how many years I've been around, and neither will it be for you. It's a gift from Christ. It's a gift from God is what salvation is. So hang on to what you know and understand. And finally, increase. Increase will happen and will take place. There may be a number of reasons why God hasn't allowed a tremendous amount of increase. Could be the environment of the church. I think for a while that was a problem. I think that there were too many problems for God to call new people in and present them with a new way of life filled with more problems. I don't think people need that. It could be the available help. You know, what are we going to do 1 year if there's a worldwide tragedy again and 50 people show up on Sabbath service that know about us from the webcast and know where we are and want to come and visit, if 50 people show up, some of us may be sitting in the other room. And how many of you can answer some of their questions? If we have, I don't think we have quite 50 people here today, but if you have 50 people here and 50 new ones come in, each of you are going to be with somebody talking to them and sharing with them what you know and what you understand. I don't know what the future holds. I do fully believe that we're going to see this church grow. I think God is going to call far more people before Christ returns than what is here. I welcome that opportunity. It's going to keep us busy. It's going to keep us involved because we're going to have our hands full. We need to see people coming in whose lives are changing, and people that come in need to see people whose lives are changing as well, and that it can be done, that it can be something that happens in life for the better, to change your life and to make it what it is. I wonder sometimes with the number of people in this media coverage that we have today are just waiting for an opportunity to show up. I know in the last couple of years they've had some small get-togethers with mailing lists in certain areas where they've had good response from it. Who knows? You know, that could happen one year here in Tyler if they were to send out for a special Sabbath service with somebody important up here speaking, you know, a little more experienced than me, and invite some people, and you had a number of people show up, that'd be refreshing for us. It'd be encouraging. But it could happen. It could happen. We live in a world that is turned upside down. We don't know what tomorrow's going to bring. But I know that whenever there is a major situation that develops, it does bring people back to church. So that could very well happen. When it does, they need to see people who are engaged with God, involved with God, and are serious about it. In the book of Peter, it talks about how that your friends and your neighbors and the people that you deal with are aware of your changing lifestyle, to put it in modern terms. They see you live day in and day out, and they see that you don't run the way that you used to run, because you have made some changes and you have committed yourself to a different direction. And when they see that, maybe in time, enough time, maybe it will do something. Well, let's see what happens. Let's see what's out there. These are just some thoughts on what we have available to us. We help plant and we help water, but it's God who gives the increase. And when the time is right and God does that, we better be ready, because we're going to be expected to go and to teach and to baptize and help those people to observe what Christ said he taught to the disciples. How successful have we been? I think we've been fairly successful. We've had to make some course corrections. We've had to consider our ways, and I think we've made some changes. I think with what's coming up this year in Land Between the Lakes is going to be very interesting. I talked to a minister this week who's from a completely different group that's going to attend with us. I spent about 30 minutes talking to him this week. Great conversation. Great interaction. And he is looking forward to it just as much as we're looking forward to having him there. So one thought I'd like to leave with you this morning: give it your best effort with the things that we are doing, with what we are learning and what we are understanding, because I don't know what the future is going to hold. I know that we're probably going to be involved, but you never know that those of us that are here today and those of us that are scattered wherever that attend church, we just may be the catalyst for somebody coming to church one of these days and changing their lives because of the example that you have set. I'm looking forward to growth, but whenever there's growth, remember, there's preparation that has to take place, because it's going to involve you and it's going to involve me and maybe a few more. But that possibility is there, so prepare for it.